So, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure to introduce the team of architects that who were selected through a very rigorous process by the University of Maryland Medical System to actually design our hospital. I want to first really, really thank Darrell Neely of the University of Maryland Medical System. He stays kind of low-key. Can you stand up? And let's give him a hand. Because there were some images of the hospital that were not so great. But Darrell has done everything he can to make sure that he selected a team that was innovative, forward-looking, but could actually put a hospital in place that worked for our community. And that team is the team of Wilmot Sands with Greg Moskowitz and Grimman Parker. Antonio Ribello is here today to talk to present. So I really hope that you like what you see. We have excellent, excellent professionals working on this project for us, and I hope you give them a rousing welcome.
Thank you all. We're really excited to be here. This is a long process, and we were brought on to take the conceptual preliminary program for the hospital and develop it into a state-of-the-art facility. You know, really we're looking to create a facility that's best in class, not a hospital of the past, but a hospital of the future. And really what we want to do is bring our insight to the community to help you do that. We're a firm that specializes in healthcare design. That's all we do. We're located in Gaithersburg, Maryland. Here we're one of the largest practices focusing strictly on healthcare design, and we're very excited to be part of the process. We teamed with Grimman Parker, who is a Prince George's County-based firm that's been here for over 40 years, and we teamed with them to help us and collaborate on the exterior design development for the project, and you'll see some really exciting images there when Antonio gets up to present. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk you through a very preliminary overview of the project from a medical planning standpoint, and just walk you through how it functions, how it works, how it sits on the site. And then Antonio will talk to you about the exterior design development and some of the ideas that, listening to you from a year ago, have been brought into the project going forward. So, very loosely, talk a little bit about the certificate of need process. For those of you who don't know, healthcare in the state of Maryland is very tightly regulated. There's a lot of oversight in the scope of a project and the program of a project for any projects over a threshold of $10 million or so. And so we're in the certificate of need process. The project was submitted about a year ago, a little over a year ago. Initially, there were completeness questions, and there's been back and forth process now. The project has been resubmitted with responses to completeness questions. After you get to a certain point in the process, the project is docketed in a certificate of need process. It comes in a very formal process where you have about 6 months or so for a decision to be made through the process, and that can stretch on sometimes if there are delays on one side or the other in providing information back and forth. But it's a long process, but we're well underway. And we'll also talk a little bit about where we are with land development, which that process has been ongoing, and then of course the medical planning and exterior design. So certificate of need was resubmitted in January 16th. We have gotten staff comments, have responded to staff comments, and of course the project calendar, the schedule for the project has everything to do with getting that certificate of need approval. And that's something of an unknown for us right now. We don't know exactly how much time it's going to take us to get through that process, but we can't really go too much further until we get that from the state. Our process began in late October, where we took the conceptual plans and the programming that had been done, and we started to refine it. And really what I was talking about, looking at best practices, national best practices for healthcare design, we looked at the concept and the, refined it to really bring it up another level in terms of quality of care, make sure that it's a very efficient, operationally efficient chassis to deliver healthcare for at least the next 50 years. We really want a hospital construction is a very long-term investment. The sketch that you see on the side, this is just a typical patient floor. And, you know, you're looking at things like sight lines from the unit secretary as people come on to the unit, controlling flow, where the charting is happening, where the team stations are. The green arrow that you see there is the public is coming in to the facility in a different way that services are coming in. So you have an onstage and offstage. For those of you who are familiar with sort of the Disney concept, where you're trying to segregate traffic flows to really create a patient-centered environment for both patients and family, where you don't see all the back-of-house things that are going on. You try to separate that. And that's a theme that's carried throughout the project. But we've completed the peer review. We've done a lot of work meeting with the engineering teams, with the Prince George's County teams, getting insight directly from the county and making sure that they understand the direction we're going and we're on track. Of course, with the Dimensions folks and the folks from the University of Maryland Medical System on really looking at each individual program within the hospital. In the land development process, the development site plan was submitted at the end of November. And that's also a process, for those of you who know it, it's a very long process, and we have gotten some initial feedback back from the staff, and we're getting ready to resubmit with some question responses there. But we're getting some great support from the planning board, and that's moving along very nicely. But we're keeping that moving, even though we don't have the final scope of the plan quite known yet in terms of the idiosyncrasies from the certificate of need. We know enough to be able to keep the land development process going. And so we are moving forward with the land development process because it has such a long timetable associated with it. And we expect or hope that we'll be in front of the planning board for review sometime in maybe late April. The site plan for the facility, for those of you who are unfamiliar with it, of course, this is I-495 right here, the Beltway. This is Arena Drive up on this side of the site, and Locksford Road over here, and Largo Town Center is located here. And of course, there's a lot of redevelopment work that's underway in the Largo Town Center, but our focus is really on this parcel of land over here, which is the land that the hospital will occupy. And the hospital has several distinct programmatic pieces. You have the hospital itself, which is here, located here, and the patient tower piece is this piece here, and I'll show you the floor plans here in a second. There's also an ambulatory care component, which is here, has a separate entry. There's also a central utility plant located over here, a large parking garage here, and then future opportunities for development around the site, and I'll show you those in a minute as well. The red arrows indicate entries in and out of the hospital at different locations, and you can see from the Arena Drive side, we have the emergency department access, and the ambulances come around the other side of the emergency department. And from Cap Center Boulevard over here, across from Largo Town Center, that's the main entrance to the hospital. Very importantly, the metro. And actually, I'll go back and make sure I point that out. You know, this is the metro station down here at the bottom of the plan. And you can see that blue line, that's the pedestrian linkage from the metro station directly up to the front door of the hospital. And there's actually a staff entrance for the hospital here, located here to reinforce that connection to mass transit for the hospital. So this is just a blow up of what we just looked at there, but you can see main entry, ambulatory care facility entry here, that's that staff entrance I was talking about by the metro, and then the ambulance entrance, and then service area back here on the back of the hospital that you've come into back off of Arena Drive over near the intersection of Oxford and Arena, and you come back around to the service side. Part of the planning also, with any medical facility, you also have to make provisions for future expansion and changes over time. And so this is a very relatively tight site. There isn't, you know, acres and acres around you. So you have to be very careful of how you plan the facility to make sure that you ensure success and the ability for growth in the future. So the hospital has been planned with the ability for there to be a future patient tower, you see here in green. The vertical expansion capability on top of the ambulatory care pavilion, which you also see in green. But there's opportunity for future clinical programs located here off of Arena Drive, located here, a future medical office building opportunity next to the parking garage, and then an opportunity for future research medical offices and parking garage located here right near the metro. And so a lot of attention to trying to make sure that it's a comprehensive solution that has the ability to change over time as needs change. So the details for the medical planning, and I'm not going to go into the minutiae of the detail, but I do want to give you a sense of how the building is organized. This is a stacking plan. What you'll see here is it layers the different departments vertically. And so this is an indication of the floor levels of the facility as you go up. These are all the patient floors, so that you have the medical surgical patient floors above the critical care, there's a behavioral health unit, and then labor and delivery below that, and then you get to a diagnostic and treatment platform that has things like surgery, emergency department, imaging, you know, your heavy diagnostics. And then the lower floor has, majority of the floor is service support areas. There is a front portion of it, a public front portion of it. I'll show you that in the plan. And this is, you can see diagrammed here, is that future patient tower potential also is in the dash area there. A little hard to read the stacking plan, but I wanted to make sure you understood that there is this vertical organization component to the building as I go through the floor plans. On the lower floor, what you have is primarily the support areas. This is really that offstage back of house area that I was talking about, where, you know, these are the things that people really aren't going to see the operation and know what's going on back behind here. There are no patients or family going back into these zones. And there's direct access from these areas to the vertical circulation over here, which is separate and distinct from the public circulation, vertical circulation. So there are two elevator floors that are going up and down through the building. There is a public zone on this level by the main entry drop-off. So there's a public concourse. And the functions that are along that concourse are, of course, access to the public elevators, but also the dining room and a conference center. And there are a few outpatient programs, and of course the linkage over to the ambulatory care pavilion on the north side of the plan north there. So you can see how it's organized on the lower level. And just as a diagram to reinforce that, support services and then public and outpatient are kind of nestled against each other, but you don't have things going all back and forth through, you know, where patients don't, or family doesn't quite know where to go, or services are interrupting that patient-centered experience. And this is really what we do in contemporary healthcare design, is pay a lot of attention to how the buildings are organized. So when you come up to the next level, the level one, we're calling it, above the concourse level, this is where you have all the diagnostic and treatment functions with your major departments of emergency and surgery and imaging, and all the things, again, for the intensive treatment and care programs. And then on the other side, you have the public elevators and the public access to those destinations. If you're going to surgery, your portal is in this direction. If you're going to the imaging, your portal is in this direction, you're headed this way, but the public is separated from the service, which is back here coming off of the completely separate elevator tour. And you see the emergency walk-in entrance is located at this side, and the ambulance entrance is located on this side, and this is in the green area here, that's your emergency department. And a CDU, that's a clinical decision unit, it's an observation area that allows you to have folks in a status that they're awaiting clinical destination, whether they're going to be discharged after some observation or referred to an inpatient status. As you go back up through the building then, you've got the next floor is a the women's and children's center floor, and on that floor you've got your labor and delivery, your NICU, your postpartum, all that is combined on one floor with great linkages and adjacencies between the different departments all together. And so again, back of house, you've got great linkage between labor and delivery and postpartum and labor and delivery and NICU. But front of house, you've got the public access also to those major departments for anybody who's coming. You know, have a nice, elegant separation there. There's also a Mount Washington program in the facility, which is the more of a long-term pediatric program that's currently located there at Dimensions, at Prince George's Hospital currently. And then, of course, the ambulatory care pavilion is over here. And by the way, this is where the connection, there's a bridge going over to the garage that's across the way that you enter the garage from Arena Drive. There is a bridge connection that comes down then this spine directly. This is the pathway into the hospital and then to this set of elevators here. There's a residency program space on the next level up, and you've got mechanical space. Now what that does is you place the mechanical facilities in between the diagnostic and treatment platforms down below and the patient cars up above. One of the things it does is it keeps the helipad fumes from the air handlers, because the helipads are going to be at the top of the building. But the other thing it also does is it creates a lot of efficiency in systems, because you're sending your systems up and down through the building from a central point instead of trying to take it all the way up and then all the way down. So there's a rationale for that as well. As you go up through the building, there's a behavioral health floor. Behavioral health floor is organized, again, as a state-of-the-art facility with gender separation, where you have separation between the male and the female populations, a shared area for therapy in between, and then separate, distinct outpatient area as well. So it's all been organized to really for best practices. And then critical care, as you go up through the floor, that's the next floor up, all glass front hallways, charting stations between pairs of rooms, so you have providers close by, so they have the opportunity to provide the care in the rooms, right outside the rooms, or in the team areas, you know, in the central floor. And again, you can see that emphasis for the separate public and patient service access that's maintained all the way up through the building. And then we get into intermediate care is really a designation that allows the patient unit to flex to a more critical status or a medical surgical status. And the major difference between this floor and, say, the critical care floor is the bathrooms. On the unit, you actually have full bathrooms in a intermediate care, because somebody may be able to you have the flexibility to use this floor as critical care or medical surgical care, depending upon what the needs of the community are. So you have to build in some flexibility into the planning. As you go up into the floors above, then this becomes more of a medical surgical platform, organized in a similar way, but you don't have the glass front rooms anymore. Now you have the oriental rooms and the nice windows looking to the outside. At the top of the building, you have the helipads, because this is a trauma center. We have helipads, and they'll come in directly into, there are two elevators that come up to the top. They'll take the trauma patients down all the way down to the emergency department, or right outside the emergency department. So that's kind of the medical planning piece of the puzzle. Gives you kind of an overview of that. And Antonio with Warren Parker is here to walk us through the exterior design evolution and show you what great things they've accomplished also.
Hello, good afternoon. How are you? Our part on this collaboration, designing this building, has to do with the exterior of the building. And you saw all those plans. And our charge is to dress the building, just like a person dresses himself or herself, and tell something about you and that person. So do buildings. And so with that, we start by studying the place where the building is going to be located, the kind of function the building is, performs, and we try to give character to the building. So the first thing that we normally do is we ask and we listen before we actually design anything. And very important for us, we ask questions like, what would make this project a success for you? And so for a year now, we've been gathering all this input of what would that be? And they become our goals. So this is not just us. It's what we listen to. And we listen to one important goal is a building that serves the community, a signature building, a building that draws people to the development, a building that makes a statement of how Prince George's County community feels about itself, a safe, accessible, inviting, and friendly building, civic architecture with an uplifting spirit and sense of hope. After all, this is a hospital. Architectural character that evokes integrity and respect. Use of light and transparency as part of the healing process of the facility. So how do we go about those goals and put that in a building? Well, we have to do that through materials. The building materials, how we dress the building, is going to allude to those goals that I just explained. And so the architectural approach is one that honors the past, celebrates the present, and looks forward to an optimistic and sustainable future. So things like masonry are solid, right? And so they evoke a sense of permanence, a sense of stability, and a sense of respect. They are permanent materials that last for many, many, many years. And so that's what we want to bring here. And we also look at the community, sense of history. What do we see around us? What kind of materials are around us? And we see that brick is prevalent in this part of George's County. What do people consider, you know, a respectful building, yet a building that looks into the future? Perhaps, you know, we are going to introduce some glass, we're going to introduce some metal, some materials that aspire to those ideas. So with that, we've been composing, and this is the current iteration of what this building could look like. And as you see, we have strived for having a masonry base in the form of brick and man-made stone at the base, and a tower that includes glass and metal and evokes a sense of hope and healing and is a signature building for Prince George's County. Yet, not trying to be too avant-garde to the point where you don't know what you're looking at. You wanted a language that is familiar to all of us and is respectful. And so this is where we are. The good news is, and I'm going to move over these slides fairly quickly because we have an exciting three-dimensional model that's live, that's actually the model we use to design the building here with us, and we're going to share that with you. So you were going to fly around and kind of look at it in that manner. This is a view that's important to all of us as well. What does the building look like from the street, from that major intersection there between Arena Drive and Oxford Road? And so we have to pay attention to that as well to be a good neighbor. So these are still images of this model that I'm about to show you. So I don't need to spend too much time there. And I'm going to switch you over to that. Okay. So this is an actual model that I can move around. So I can back up a little bit, and I'll show you the facility here. Okay. So you get an idea from the sky, if we're flying, we're a bird, and you see, let me try to situate you, that behind there is the arena drive. It's going to be generated. That's the arena drive right there. That's lots of light there. The metro station is right here, the big parking garage existing here. These developments here, this is future development. This is not part of the project. We just included it, so you get an idea of how this area could develop, but we really have nothing to do with this part here. But you can see how that is relating to everything else. If you come from the metro, you actually have one of the most welcoming sites to this development here. So that rendering that you saw earlier is what you see, or what you will see as you walk from the metro towards the building. Also, that's the main entrance for cars and for people to be dropped off at the entrance of the hospital. You see there's a nice canopy here that will protect you from the elements, from the rain, from the snow. And as you move in, the main doors will be located at the lobby here, which would be a very nice lobby, up high area here. Right above the lobby, as you see, we try to locate zones as much as we can for contemplation, for an exterior area that one could actually come out of the hospital and go outside. As you turn around, and I'm going to try to do this slowly so I don't have anybody's sick here. This year is the outpatient care facility. This would be a bridge that will eventually connect to the parking garage, which is a county project. It's now actually immediately related to this project right now. But it will be where people would park. This is the emergency entrance, as you can see. As you come from Arena Drive, that's what you see as you drive in. We also paid a lot of care on the elevations, meaning the facades of this building, all around, because we think this building has no back. This building is visible all the way around. And so there's no such thing as we can't pay attention to this here. This building is going to be seen and appreciated by everyone. And so with that, these are the patient rooms. We try to give that sense of solidity, integrity, respect, and hope. When you look at the facade line like this, you can imagine all the possibilities and how this hospital can actually look from all angles. So these are the service areas here. Let me show you the ambulance area right here, where the ambulances would park. Right behind us, because this is such a large facility, this is a central utility plant, which will have the same care in its design, so that it doesn't look like some factory or something behind it. It actually looks friendly to the community, yet is a functional building. It's not a building where patients would go or anything. And so as you turn around, you can see how we have interwoven these materials that are masonry materials, the stone, and I can zoom in. You can take a look at what these things look like. So you have a very nice warm palette of stone, of metal, and of brick. Because of the size of this building, we are proposing a blend of materials and not a one single color, so that there is some it's not a monotonous facade of these walls that you have. So just to quickly explain you how this thing is working, this is the side where there's also patient rooms up here. These would be the elevator lobby. So you come out, there's a nice glassy area. And I'm sorry, the elevator lobby is actually right here. and then in plan you transition to where you have some living rooms right here. If you're going to visit someone into the hospital, that's where you could sit before moving in there. And this area right here, as you see, where the logo is in metal for several reasons. One of them, because that was a little easier to remove once the addition, which is proposed, to be located right on top of this thing here, this roof, then you can add and connect to get to that elevator core, which are solid pieces because the elevators are behind you of this of these things. So the building is responding to the plan, what the plan needs to do inside, and we carefully crafted the materials around it so that it is a building that is proper for the patients, for the visitors, and for the staff that will work in this facility. And with that, I think I'm done presenting this. This will open it for questions. Thank you.
So, any questions? We're happy to take any questions for the next steps. We already talked about COI docketing as a process that we've talked about that we're going to be going through. Obviously, refining the design and then presentation to the Prince George County Planning Board, you know, as the design goes forward.
So, what do you think? Is this not what you've been waiting for here in Prince George's County? Many of you participated in the process a year ago. You told us what you liked, what you didn't like, what you wanted. And I think we have delivered. What do you think about the future of Prince George's County health care services? Is this not what you wanted? So they're ready, and we're ready to take your question.
I have a question relating to the helipad. In Chevrolet, the residents in Chevrolet complain of noise coming in and picking and going out. What is the situation going to be in Lago with the helipad?
Well, the helipad is, as you saw, the helipad is located at the roof level, and part of the design team will be an acoustical engineer, where we look at making sure that we mitigate noise, sound, and vibration for the principally. We're looking at it for the hospital itself because you have resident rooms, patient rooms, you know, very close proximity to the helipads. Because it's where it is in elevation, how high it is and where it's located, that's probably the best location that we can have for mitigating any kind of impact to any neighbors, you know, associated with the facility. If we had it on the ground right next to, you know, whatever the development was here or there, it would actually be much harder to mitigate the any kind of sound or vibration.
I just have one more question. How does the new hospital relate to the trauma center in Baltimore? Will there be a relationship?
Well, that's the relationship between the new hospital and the University of Maryland Medical System is evolving. So I don't really know ultimately what it is. I don't think they do yet either, but there's certainly a collaboration in the works. I don't know where it is right now.
Hi, I'm Cheryl Court. I'm with the Coalition for Smarter Growth, and we've worked with county residents to support the efforts to bring this great regional medical center to the Largo Metro Station. We're so excited that we're at this point, and I just wanted to say I think that the design concepts are very attractive. We're really excited with what you've been able to do. I do have one concern, which is the relationship between the front of the building and the adjacent shops and restaurants and sort of opportunity for economic development. The depiction shows a very wide, high-speed roadway with some cars on it, and it shows a lot of open, passive open space that I think that both of those elements could lead to isolating the hospital from activity on the other side of that street, and what kind of considerations that can be done to tighten that up and really create a great walkable, connected environment.
Yeah, that's a great observation, and the probably we'll just need to be refined as the development for the Largo Town Center evolves as well. You know, as you know, there's another development group that's working on that, and so we just have to continue to collaborate with them as they gel their plans, you know, without having much control or any control really of exactly what they're doing. We have to kind of react, and we don't want that road to be a barrier, though. We do want to see if we can find ways to create a connection, not only for the Largo Town Center, but because there's also that area where I showed you the opportunity for future research, medical office building, development. Part of the health complex will be over there on that side of the road as well. So we want that interconnection. So, but it is tricky because there will be traffic there that you have to craft a solution for. So, but it's a good observation.
My question actually relates to what the lady just spoke about. In many of our communities, we have the crossover. And I was thinking some of the same things from a safety perspective. Regardless of who the builders are and who's developing where, I think it's very important that they all work together for the safety of the entire community of Prince George's County. So there are many crossovers. You know, they build it up and you walk across instead of on the streets. These are major thoroughfares. It's going to get busier as the developments proceed. The hospital's going to have more activity. The new developments will have more activity. Largo Town Center will have more activity, more traffic. So if we can get the foot traffic over a bridge to cross these roadways, and I really had in mind even from the metro, because you have people coming from the metro, I wasn't able to get a good perspective from your layout of the metro actually exiting the metro and accessing the hospital pathway. But if there is something, if there's a street there, that might be another good place for a crossover. Now, this may be something that the county needs to look into and may be a little beyond just this project, but I'm sharing it so that maybe somewhere in our communication we can talk about the safety perspective of using these crossovers, which are very common now in our communities.
Yeah. Again, great observation. The connection to Metro actually doesn't cross a roadway, so that's actually the siting of the building and the campus actually is excellent from that standpoint. It's, the pedestrian linkage doesn't cross a major arterial, so that's a very good thing.
And a part of the approval process will involve the planning board looking at those transportation connections, so that will be studied during the approval process.
Good afternoon. I'm a systems analyst in the field of healthcare information technology, and the hospital is beautiful. I love it. But I did not notice an area for the IT department, and it's been my experience that many hospitals tend to overlook that in their plans and development, and we're just like scattered everywhere. You need server rooms, places for inventory. Has that been included in the plan?
Yes. Actually, IT, as you mentioned, in modern healthcare, because of the importance of connecting information, is the backbone of a facility. And so there is a pretty robust IT department integrated in to the planning. I didn't point it out, but it is there.
Thanks. Will the architectural firm be selecting the materials for inside the hospital? I'm concerned about the quality of the materials in terms of health and best practices today.
Yes, absolutely. We're, as I mentioned, all we do is healthcare design, and we have a team of interior designers, and all they do is healthcare interior design work. And so working closely with, you know, Dimensions and the other stakeholders, we'll be very careful to have finishes that are not only durable, but also from an infection control standpoint are appropriate, and also are healing in the sense that you're creating warm materials that are really reinforcing that healing environment on the public side of the house. So there's a lot of things that we really take very seriously in the development. And yes, we will be responsible for that and take actually great pride in doing that.
So they won't be things that off-gas formaldehyde or other chemicals then?
No, actually the project is required to be a LEED silver project, and a lot of those selections, of course, as you know, are precluded as part of that process as well, so yeah.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Byron. I just wanted to reiterate the last question before we went on break. I don't see the gentleman here. He was asking about where we are with the fundraising for the building.
Well, that's from the building. Yeah.
So from a funding perspective, sorry, I have to take him out. From a funding perspective, this project is roughly a $600 million project, and there's a funding source from the state, from the county, and then as part of a financial improvement plan, those three entities make up the funding of the project.
He was asking how much do we have and how much do we have to go to raise?
So the money has already been allocated, so to speak, budgeted for, as long as years in the future that the state continues to fund the project and the county continues to fund it, it's been planned out over a series of years. Did I answer your question?
Okay, you remember the county executive indicated that we need your help. And that, you want to come on?
Can I help a little bit? Mm-hmm. The county executive, I think, can y'all hear me?
No.
What the county executive was making reference to was operating funds for the current hospital and the way it operates. Right now, the state contributes $15 million in an annual subsidy, as does Prince George's County. So the county will continue its $15 million subsidy, and the county executive wants the state government under the new administration to understand that we must have a continuing $15 million annual operating contribution. So that's separate from what I think the question is, which is the capital payment for the building itself. The county has set aside actually $208 million. That's all taken care of. We're straight with that. The state has pretty much set aside the $208 million of its contribution, and we know exactly how the other part of the financial structure is coming together. So we have very good confidence that the financing plan and structure is in order to build the building. Now, anything can happen, but we have, you know, spent a lot of money so far in getting through the planning and design process. We have acquired the property that's necessary. We are making all the necessary plans, so I have very little doubt that there's a danger to this project in terms of its financing.
I just add one comment. The CON that we keep referring to is kind of the kickoff. Once that CON is approved, there's a lot of dominoes that happen that trigger the project moving forward. So that's why we keep bringing the CON up. It's a process that takes a lot of time, but once that process has been approved, then everything else is set in motion to go.
Hi, my name is Reginald. I'm a resident of the county, and right in the Larkin Town Center of condos, right across the street from the Metro. I have a couple of questions and maybe any one suggestion. First question is regarding the CON. What's the process or length of time can we expect to see this certificate of need continue until we see a definite answer, yay or nay? Second question is what will happen to the boulevard as far as the retail establishments that currently exist on the site? How would they be repositioned in respect to the new hospital? And then my last suggestion, maybe for the county, maybe consider having like a special bond issue to raise money for the hospital construction, whether it's for operating needs or for other purposes. Maybe have a referendum where we approve or vote for a special bond issue, or just have an investment opportunity where any county resident can invest in a bond that specifically supports funding the hospital. That's the suggestion. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your question. So regarding the development of the properties across the way, as you know, there's another development entity involved in that. So don't really have a good answer for you, only because we don't know exactly what their timetable is. But I know that they're working on it, or we know that they're working on it. So that's that piece of the puzzle. As far as the certificate of need timetable, there are mandated, once the certificate of need is docketed, and that's kind of the key, and everybody can kind of watch for that when they see that happens. Once it's docketed, then there's actually some statutory regulations relative to how much time can transpire before you start to get a decision. And we're not at the docketing stage yet, and we're pushing hard, working real hard to try and get there. And exactly how long that takes, we don't know, because that's where the questions go back and forth, where they're asking, you know, for more information. And we've been at it for a while now, so we're hopeful that we're getting close to that, but we don't know. And it could be where we have a decision in 6 months from now, it could be a year from now, we just don't know. But we don't expect it to be 5 years from now. I mean, it's obviously a shorter duration than that, but we don't know exactly what the time frame is. And then your suggestion on financing, I don't know, Betty, you might want to.
If you refresh my recollection about what
was about the finance. I could have a bond issue just for that purpose, to address any financial gaps that may be relevant in the hospital construction and operating expenses.
We have a very brilliant CFO for the county, and we are actually not issuing the same type of bonds that we normally would for a capital project. There is another financing mechanism that's being used for this. I don't want to misstate exactly what it is, but this is not a standard way that we finance projects. But the money has been set aside already.
Hi, thanks for your presentation. It was very informative. Two questions. I live in Lake Arbor, and a lot of us in that community and the surrounding area, people do a lot of walking and running. So as people want to walk and run, even all the way over to the boulevard, so what are your plans to ensure that this whole area remains walkable so that people can continue to stay fit? That's the first question. And the second question, a lot of times in hospitals and other healthcare facilities, you see that, you know, their doctors and nurses are working hard to ensure the health of the patients, but they themselves often are not in good physical shape. And obviously we would want them to be, especially if we're trying to get more of them to come to our area. Where in the hospital, or if you haven't thought of this yet, any possibility of some kind of fitness room, fitness center within the hospital so that the people who work there, because many of them work really long hours and they're less likely to go to a fitness facility elsewhere, any opportunity for a fitness center there, and also within the hospital, and also if you have people who have family members that are there for extended period of time, that might be a good opportunity for the family members who are in the hospital visiting to actually get some stress off by exercising.
From the walkable community standpoint, obviously it's a relatively compact site, but there will be, you know, walking paths in and around, and of course that will be part of the landscape development for the project, and that's very important because we have connections to the parking garage and the metro and things that we have to reinforce that pedestrian linkage too, and so that will be part of the planning detail. Relative to the fitness center development internally to the hospital, there are program spaces for rehabilitation and cardiac rehab and things like that in the facility. I don't know to the extent that we haven't gotten to that level of user group detailed discussion about employee fitness yet, or that program element, but that would be a good, yeah, that'd be a good suggestion to take to the planning team to just, you know, make that suggestion and see, because and it does there are employee fitness centers that are integrated into major campuses. It's not an unusual thing to see from time to time, so that'd be a good suggestion to take.
Hi, good afternoon. Can you explain the outpatient portion again? So are you saying that the outpatient building will be ready when the hospital is ready, or is that part two where you're building on top of portions of the hospital later on? My specific question is, for instance, Holy Cross will have physical therapy on the first floor. They'll have inpatient for the patients in the hospital, but then they'll also have an outpatient center where people outside the hospital can come and take their referrals to the hospital and get the care that they need. So I'm just trying to figure out if that outpatient setting will be immediately available when the hospital is built.
Yeah, it's planned. The ambulatory care building is planned as part of the initial construction, but it's planned for vertical expansion as well. So it's planned to have an additional 3 stories structurally so that it can handle growth. And then there's also some outpatient program areas that are part of that base of the hospital as well. It's not all in the ambulatory care building, but there are some outpatient programs along that public concourse up on the side that heads towards the ambulatory care. There were some outpatient programs there as well. So there are outpatient programs integrated in to the initial plan.
Okay, so to follow up on that, will those medical providers be supplied by University of Maryland, or will the hospital be looking for outside caregivers to provide those services?
Dr. Cooper will answer.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Cooper.
Allow the current staff, or who we have, which staff at ambulatory care sites will be coming over to be part of the ambulatory care sites as well. As we move forward with development of this entire program, there will be more integration of the University of Maryland into what we're doing. But our physicians who are currently part of our hospital will be very much an integral part of what we're doing moving forward. Answer your question.
Outside providers?
We will certainly, as you've noticed, there are a number of new developments in the new hospital that we don't have now, which is very exciting to us. The Cancer Center, for example, is one of those things. So as we develop those new things, there certainly will be a new staff that we brought in. We'd be more developed than I think of OB services. There are a number of new services that come through the medical center that we're bringing in new providers as needed.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. It will be interesting to know what the assumed health impact of this infrastructure is for Prince George's County residents. And I'm also wondering, has there been a health impact assessment done? And if so, what were the findings of that assessment? And where could a resident find that information?
Thank
Thank you. Pam Gregory, Health Department. So a health impact assessment is done on every new development project for the county. Thanks to our county council, they passed legislation about 2012, I believe. And so what we do as a health department, along with planning, is do a health impact assessment for every new project. I think our first project was the Tanger Outlet mall that's opened up down there. So we do, and we take it very seriously, as you were talking about, walkable communities and all of those things. There are six principles we focus on. We are staffed now. We do a lot of tabletop HIAs, but the first full-fledged one we participated in was a project over at College Park. This would absolutely be a full-fledged HIA project. Thank you.
Is the HIA for this particular project, is it available now?
Can we take one of your savings? We're not there yet.
Okay. Thank you.
I probably have a similar question to some of the other people that have come up to the mic. I think, you know, I've been photographing the boulevard since I moved here. And every time there's a construction project, I start photographing. I've been photographing Fortune Johnson's project as soon as they broke ground. I've been looking at what's going to happen with Ascend Apollo over at in front of the metro station. I think the missing link for those of us who live here is what this is going to look like. And I think the biggest missing piece for us is what's going to happen with the boulevard. I already know the parking lot where the theater is going away. I know that. I've been told that. But what's happening is, where is that dividing line? Where does the dividing line from the hospital start or end, and whatever is remaining of the retail establishment at the boulevard begins? I am guessing, because I don't know, I'm just guessing, that what we know today is the boulevard is going away. Now, if that's in fact the case, then I think what the planning board might want to consider doing is somehow giving those of us who live here, I live across the street in Shreetop, you know, giving those of us who live here some kind of visual idea. I mean, the hospital is beautiful, but what we don't know is what's on the other side of that, not on the lots but roadside, but on the side where Arena Drive exists. So, example, if I'm standing at the corner at Lotsford Arena, and I'm looking at the hospital, I'm looking at FedEx Field. What else am I looking at if I'm looking at Longhorn Restaurant? So that's the missing piece. There's only so much land, because I walk all the time. I walk from the Metro Center, and then I walk over to take my pictures of through the boulevard, stop and eat a Chick-fil-A, then I go to Arena Drive to take pictures of Fortune Johnson. So now I'm walking that. So there's only a finite amount of land between that Metro Center stop and Fortune Johnson on Arena Drive. So if you sit the hospital right there at the Metro Center, what's going to be on the other side of it? I think that's what the question we have in our mind.
Well, and it's great. I
know you can't answer. I think that's a county question. That's a county question.
So I can try to answer your question. The site that's on the other side of we call Hospital Drive, the existing retail, is going to be developed by a company called RPAI. And RPAI is in the, we'll call it the infancy stages of planning what they want to do with the site over there. You know, they're looking at condominiums. Everything will have a retail base with structure above. So it's going to be something that's going to evolve over time. We don't have the answers right this minute, but I can tell you they're anticipating pretty much touching everything on that site except for the movie theater. Over time. It's not going to happen tomorrow, but that is their intent at this point in time. And what we have done so far, since we are probably way out in front of them, is trying to make sure that what we do is going to align with what they will do in the future. Roadways and connections and things like that. Okay?
Are there any other questions?
I know many of you sat through a planning process for the longer sector plan where we talked about the hospital, we talked about transportation, we also made recommendations. We worked with RPAI in talking about what could happen. I ask you to go visit that plan. You can find that on our website in the planning department and take a look at that plan. But as everyone said, it's still developing. I want to thank you, all of you, for your patience today. I hope you like what you have seen. I hope you have digested what you have heard. And you will take that information back to the residents who are not here today. We need you to stay involved in this process. This is not the end. When it goes, you get a document, it goes to the planning board, they need you there at the planning board to say, this is where we want to go. So we encourage you to stay tuned to when this is going to the planning board sometime in April and be a part of that discussion. Again, on behalf of the county and our county executive, Rushern Baker III, and Elizabeth Hewlett, who is our chairman of the Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission, our health department, and more specifically, Betty Hager Francis, we thank you for coming out this afternoon, this morning, and staying through the afternoon. Again, thank you so much. But I would be remiss without saying one thing. My partner, and it always takes a team, Glenda Hatton, who is the project manager, please raise your hand, has been crucial to moving this forward, and the team of staff support that we have had has been tremendously great. So again, thank you so much, and have a wonderful afternoon.